Amazing. And I think we are live right now.
Glenn says live.
Awesome. Thank you, brothers. Thank you, everyone, for hopping on. Thank you for joining us for another installment of our weekly Shabbat series. Today, we have a very, very special guest, very special brother, very special rabbi to all of AEPI. Not only is he a mentor of mine, but there are very few brothers in AEPI's history that have impacted as many brothers as our brother and our rabbi that we're featuring today. And the beauty of this is that we start with everything going on, and especially this week as more and more states continue to open up, as they continue every week, that glimmer of hope is becoming much larger of a light. And it's almost symbolic of the rabbi that is leading us into Shabbat today, as he has been that light for so many of us. I am blessed and honored to introduce Rabbi Shalom Denbo, founder of AEPI Jerusalem Road Trips, founder of AEPI's Hineni Conference, which we hold in conjunction with our international convention, one that I've actually personally attended as well, and it's absolutely life-changing. Author, mentor, mensch, all of the above. Rabbi, thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much for leading all of AEPI into Shabbat today.
Thank you, Josh. My pleasure. Shabbat Shalom, brothers. Thank you so much for joining. Thank you for watching. First and foremost, a very humbling introduction. I do have to correct Josh. There are definitely many brothers that have impacted many more brothers than I have. I sit in the shadows of two very dear friends of mine, Andy Borenz and Elon Carr, who I know have affected way more brothers than I have. And they are just on the surface. There are many others, but I do appreciate the words. Thank you very much. It is an honor to be involved with the Brotherhood. You know, we're in a time right now, Josh mentioned that there are openings that are happening, and it's slow, but hopefully it will become more steady and continue to become more and more open. You know, that word open, closed, it's a very debilitating phrase to think about. These are scary times, times where people feel isolated, people feel alone, people feel very apprehensive about the future. And it's specifically at times like this that it is very rewarding, very comforting to know that we're not alone, that we do have our brothers, we do have people that are dear to us, people that are there, even though they are not physically with us, they are always with us, standing by us, whether near, whether far. And that's the power of the brotherhood. That's the power of relationships. The famous story of Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva, one of the greatest leaders the Jewish people ever had. And Rabbi Akiva did not embark on his career as a Jewish leader. He didn't even embark on his education as a Jew until he was 40 years old. And that subsequently led until a leadership position where he led the Jewish people throughout some very troubling times, even more troubling times than we live in right now, even though these are scary times. Rabbi Akiva lived through the Roman persecution and the destruction. And when Rabbi Akiva was finally at the end of his life being tortured and killed by the Romans, the way he was killed was unbelievably traumatic. They took a metal comb and they were combing the flesh off of his body. And his students were standing around watching aghast at this image. And Rabbi Akiva seemed to be somewhat smiling. And he said, Shema Yisrael, and he said the Shema, and he said it with joy. He said, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. And his students cried out to him and said, Rebbe, do you really have to be joyful, Ad Kidei Kach, even until this moment where you're being tortured? Is that required? Is that how we're supposed to live? That when we're being tortured and persecuted as Jews, we're supposed to smile and rejoice in that? And Rabbi Akiva said, no, you're not obligated to do that. You're not obligated to rejoice. You can cry. It's painful. Rabbi Akiva said, but b'chol yom, every day of my life, I actually prayed for this. Every day of my life, I prayed that if the moment came where I had to put my life on the line for being a Jew, that I would have the courage and conviction to do that. And now that that moment has actually come, that opportunity has presented itself, I shouldn't rejoice? Of course I should rejoice. In this week's Torah portion, we have the mitzvah of Kiddush Hashem. This week's Torah portion is Parshas Emor. And we have the mitzvah of what's known as Kiddush Hashem, sanctifying the holy name. And all the commentaries say, what does it mean to have a mitzvah of Kiddush Hashem? The mitzvah of Kiddush Hashem, sanctifying God's name, is exactly what Rabbi Akiva was doing. Rabbi Akiva sanctified God's name because we are told that we have to be willing to give up our lives as Jews. You know, ironically, today, you know, as Josh, when Josh asked me if I would speak, I was troubled with what do I pick to speak about? There are so many things right now at this time frame that one could speak about. Obviously, we could speak about the situation of the coronavirus. We could speak about the period of the calendar that we're in, the Omer. We could speak about Lag BaOmer, famous holiday that's coming up next week. And of course, leading up to the holiday of Shavuot. But I was told that this is a Friday opportunity. This is an Erev Shabbat talk. And therefore, I thought it was appropriate to speak about the mitzvah that's in this week's Torah portion of Kiddush Hashem. And the mitzvah of Kiddush Hashem is exactly, as I said, putting one's life on the line, but specifically because they're a Jew. Today also happens to mark the end, the declaration of the end of World War II. That is today, Friday, May 8th, is the day that World War II ended. And how incredibly auspicious a time to speak about the mitzvah of Kiddush Hashem when you had the 6 million Kedoshim, the 6 million Jews that all died for Kiddush Hashem. They died simply because they were Jews. That's the mitzvah of Kiddush Hashem. The Torah is telling us that we have to have that conviction within us. Now that's a perplexing idea that the Torah is actually saying that we should be willing to die for our Jewish identity. When the Torah is the source of the sanctity of life, the Torah is the thing that brought the concept into the world of the dignity of the human being, the sanctity of life, that life should be cherished at all costs. So why, in that very doctrine of Judaism that says life is to be valued, life is to be cherished, life is to be saved, would there be a commandment that you have to be willing to give up your life? And that's because my teacher, my rabbi, Rabbi Noach Weinberg of blessed memory, he said an incredible line. He said that if a person doesn't know what they're willing to die for, then they haven't begun living. That's a very heavy question we have to ask ourselves. What am I willing to die for? I was brought into this world. You know, the only thing I like to tell my students, the only thing that our parents teach us by osmosis, without actually trying to teach us something, is the very fact that they brought us into this world is that life is going to end. There must have been a valuable reason to bring us in anyway, unless, of course, we were a mistake, but that's a separate discussion. So Rabbi Weinberg, to demonstrate this idea, used to tell the following story, an amazing story about a man that he met. He was going fundraising around Israel, and he met a man up in Haifa. And this man happened to be a fabulously wealthy individual. He owned lots of docks. He owned the dock space in Jaffa and in Haifa, and so he made a tremendous fortune in the import-export industry that was in Israel. Prior to the founding of the State of Israel, he was part of a group known as the Stern Gang. It became later known as the Lehi. And the Stern Gang was a very specific group in the founding of the State of Israel. And they had a very unique perspective that they thought that the British had to go at all costs. Some people referred to them, therefore, as extremists for some of their actions. And this individual is part of the Stern Gang. And part of the rule of the Stern Gang is you were not allowed to get caught by the British. Because if you were captured by the British, they were known to torture, and they'd have to give up secrets, and the Stern Gang could be caught. And this individual carried a gun with him at all times. And sure enough, one time, he was ratted out to the British. They knew where he was. He wasn't aware of this. And he had gone into the shuk, he had gone into the open market. And when they found out that he was in the open market, they had cornered it off. And they had only had one exit where you could get out of the market, and they were searching people. They were looking for him. And he was unaware of this, as I mentioned, so he took the gun, because if he got caught with the gun, he figured he'd be arrested. He didn't know that they were looking for him, and so he hid the gun. But sure enough, they took him anyway. So this way, he wasn't able to fight his way out, and they arrested him. And they ended up torturing him to the point where he lost a leg. And while he was in captivity, the war broke out. And when the war broke out, the British left, and therefore the Israelis were left on their own to fight the Arabs. And of course, thankfully, we know the victory took place and the state of Israel was declared. Now, when the state of Israel was declared, there were primarily two jobs for a person in Israel at that time. You either were a farmer building the land, or you were in the army. That's it. Well, this individual that Rabbi Weinberg went to meet, well, he couldn't be a farmer. He had lost his leg. He had no way to building up a farm. And the army didn't want him. Therefore, he had no idea what he was going to do. And he decided, he realized that if Israel's going to survive, they're going to have to eventually depend on an import-export part of the economy as well. And so he scrapped together some money and he started buying up a dock and then another dock and then another dock and then another dock. Until finally he had owned a significant amount of the docks and he made a fortune. Rabbi Weinberg was meeting with him and he was hearing stories about his life, how he had owned a yacht, he had homes around the world in Europe and in Israel. And Rabbi Weinberg asked him, he says, tell me, what was the most fabulous experience of your life with all of these things that you've done? And the man looked at Rabbi Weinberg and he says, Rabbi, I don't understand your question. I thought you were a wise individual. How could you ask me that question? For 2 years of my life, when I was fighting for the Jewish people, my life was on the line. I knew I could have been killed at any moment. And therefore, I was living for the Jewish people. He said, how could anything ever compare to that? If a person knows what they're willing to die for, Judaism is telling us that that's what you have to understand. God forbid any of us should ever be asked to die for that. But we should have the clarity and the conviction to know what it is that we're willing to die for. And then Judaism says, now live for it. That's what Kiddush Hashem means. Kiddush Hashem means that God forbid we should have to die for it. But we should have the understanding that our Jewish identity is something to be cherished, something to be embraced, something that we should be willing, if God forbid the Germans ever marched again, if God forbid the Arabs ever marched into the land of Israel, if God forbid brothers standing on campus should never look the other way and hide for being a Jew, as our brothers don't. But every Jew, not just the brothers that are involved, every Jew should be willing to stand up and say, I'm willing to take a stand for the Jewish people. Because that's what it means to be Kiddush Hashem. You know, we live in a crazy time right now. We live in a time where things are shut down, and yes, it's slowly opening. But we live in a time where we have been reminded what's really important in life. You know, Jerry Seinfeld was came out with a new comedy special, and so he was interviewed by, I think it was Jimmy Kimmel. And Jimmy Kimmel asked him how life was in his world with the coronavirus. And he actually had an incredible line. He said, this doesn't faze me that much. It just reminds us all that we're not that consequential. That we are nothing compared to nature. Mother Nature will always win. And Judaism says, you're right, Jerry. That is correct. That humanity versus human, versus nature, versus the universe, versus the world at large is insignificant, each one of us. But he's incorrect to say that we are inconsequential. Our lives matter. Our lives are holy. Our lives are significant. This coronavirus has reminded us that that rat race that got shut down in a nanosecond is not what life is all about. Life is about something so much more profound. Our lives are holy. Because what does it mean, holy? You know, the word holy, it's a very strange word. We think we understand what it is, holy, and we immediately think of something religious. But that's not what holy means. The word holy just means sanctified, means that it's set aside. It's different than everything else. Here we are. We're about to enter Shabbos. And the way we enter Shabbos, we make Kiddush. We sanctify the day. What does it mean to sanctify the day? We make a declaration that this day is different than every other day of the week. That's what holy means. Holy means to set aside, to sanctify. It's the same word we use for marriage. When a man and a woman get married, it's called kiddushin, sanctifying. We're saying that this relationship, this marriage, this unity between these two people is different than every other relationship. That's what holy means. You see, each one of us has a mitzvah of Kiddush Hashem. Each one of us has a mitzvah to sanctify our lives. Even right now, when we're not being asked to die for the Jewish people, thank God. Hopefully we will never be asked to die for the Jewish people again. But Rabbi Akiva said, every day, I pray that I will have the opportunity to do Kiddush Hashem, to sanctify my life. You know how you can sanctify your life every day? Ask yourself every day, first and foremost, what am I living for? What's worth dying for? But even more than that, every day ask yourself, how can I sanctify my life as a Jew? Once a week, stop. Every Friday night, take out a glass of wine, take out some grape juice, and just say, today is Shabbos. Just saying those words is Kiddush. Yes, you should say the blessing, but just saying, today is Shabbos, sanctifies the day, sanctifies my life. Every day, do a mitzvah. The Hebrew word mitzvah, we think it means commandment, but it comes from the word to connect. A mitzvah connects us to our Jewish identity. Every day, figure out how you can connect to your Jewish identity, and that will sanctify your life. And that will make your life so much more profound than anything else that exists in the world. Hopefully soon, this corona will be eradicated. Hopefully anyone who has been affected by it in an actual sickness will be healed, b'mehira v'yameinu, and the whole world will be healed from all sickness. This day is the day when World War II ended. It's still a sign that there's a sickness in the world, a sickness of hatred, a sickness of bigotry. Hopefully all of that will end and all of our lives will be sanctified. This is something that we in AIPI know so well, that our lives are profound. Wishing all of my brothers a wonderful Shabbos. Thank you so much for listening.
Rabbi, thank you. Thank you so, so much. And I wanted to share a quick story with you before we conclude. The idea of Kiddush Hashem, about a week ago, and I shared this last week, you mentioned Andy Borenz and Elon Carr. There was a consortium of Jewish organizations that got together to deliver PPE equipment to frontline workers and to healthcare workers in need that didn't have it. And Andy and Elon both volunteered themselves to go and deliver that equipment. And before we could even, the rest of the staff found out, we asked Andy why. And the only thing he said is, we must. It's our duty. And Andy himself put on his letters and went off, and Elon did the same. And it's just incredibly powerful. For all the brothers watching, for all of us joining, this is only a taste. Join us on Monday for an amazing webinar with Rabbi Denbo. And we're very, very excited to see all of our webinars, to see everything that AIPI is providing in these times. Please check out www.aipi.org/connect. Rabbi, thank you so much. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom to all the brothers here. And I look forward to seeing you all when this clears up and next week as well online.
Amen. Shabbos.